Finn.
And I'm Sawyer. And you're listening to Our House, A to Z.
All right. Welcome back.
Happy Friday, everybody. Not that you're probably listening to it necessarily on a Friday, but if it is.
Right. We're not even recording it on a Friday.
Definitely not.
Yeah, it feels weird. But I love Wednesdays, too.
So. I love Wednesdays.
Wednesdays are our staff meeting day.
Yep.
And that is like one of my favorite days of the week because I am obsessed with our staff.
We have a great staff.
We have an incredible team and a very like diverse team in abilities and giftings and burdens. And it's just cool.
It is cool. I love our staff. And we love our staff kids. And there's like a million. And you might actually hear some high shrill noises during this podcast.
Right.
Nobody's being hurt. I think there's like an intense game of football going on
right outside our office here. Yeah, where we're recording this. So great. That's,
it's so fun. Everything's good. Safe.
So fun. So we have some things coming up at the church that we want to make sure everybody who's listening is tuned into.
Yes. So a few things is you might remember we had Pastor Will and Lori on here talking about some racism issues going on right now. And we had said keep your ear out because some stuff's going to be coming up. So something's coming up this Sunday. So that will be June 28th on Sunday night here at the church. We're going to be hosting a little anti-racism conversation among friends. So we're looking forward to that. You do have to register, so make sure you jump on the church website. You can hit the little tab there and register. Let us know you're coming. I think it's at 6:30. 6:30 at night?
Sounds right.
Yeah,
and
sounds right.
It's not that little anymore. Apparently, they have over 70 people signed up. And the panel has some really good names on it that I'm excited to hear from and I think will be very eye-opening and educational and just bring about the awareness that we really need on this. So,
right. It's not going to be recorded. We've had a few people ask. It's not going to be recorded. It's really kind of for friends and family. So we want it to be a comfortable, safe environment for everybody. But we do encourage you to come out to that. And another thing that's coming up, if you weren't here on Sunday or you didn't get the church email, we have our church service and picnic on July 12th. So make sure you mark that down. We want to see everybody there. We're going to have service out at the Swansea YMCA at 10 o'clock on Sunday, July 12th.
Amen. Right.
That's it. Little housekeeping stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. Anyway, awesome. All right. So we are coming at you today with a really cool topic that was recommended by none other than our very own Dan O'Connell.
Yeah.
So he's
shout out to the O'Connells.
Yes, Dan and Andrea have just been such a huge blessing, and him sharing his testimony at church and just being a guy around here, smiling at people and loving on people. He's been so encouraging. So thank you,
Dan. And Andrea gave her testimony at Ladies Retreat this year, and it was so good.
Yeah.
So good. So we love you guys.
Yes, thank you for this topic. And the topic today is, how do you live in the world and not be of it? Like, how do we...
Like all summed up. That's basically what the question was.
How do you engage in things, or do you engage? Can we engage? Do we have the freedom to engage in so much of the secular world around us while still retaining our faith, while still retaining our righteousness, while still walking in obedience and in the Spirit?
Right. And I think this is a great question because it's so applicable, but in completely different ways for all seasons of your walk with Christ.
Yes, it is.
The truth is pretty general and you can always fall back on it, but culture is constantly changing. So what is our role as Christians, as culture changes, to remain those consistent examples of Christ?
Yeah, and first of all, let me just say how much I appreciate his concern on this topic. And I'll say as a pastor, you know, there's a part of me, it's been joked about that, like, if we started a commune, like, how many of our church would, like, move in? And could we, like, actually become this, like, isolated Christian community?
That's because every time you say it with such conviction that it even makes me nervous.
I really could do it, honestly.
I'm not ready for
that.
I
love our people that much. But there's a heart there that says we want to protect people. In the same way that the New Testament writers and some of these apostles and church leaders, and when you talk to a good pastor, and I know some awesome pastors, way more shepherding hearts than I have, and there's a desire to protect people from the secular world. In fact, when we first moved into this mall that we're in right now, I remember just like, I'm not gonna say it was from the Lord, but having this sort of vision, might have just been me, but seeing, like, what if a church owned a mall that still was full of stores and had all of the restaurants and all of the retail shops and the anything that you'd find in a mall now, but it was all done under the Christian covering of, you know, how you have employers and employees, and in addition to their working relationship, they were brothers and sisters in Christ, where they're holding each other accountable. And now add to that living space where your roommate, if you're a young adult, a young single, and you're rooming with another young single, and they're saying, hey, where'd you go after work tonight? Why are you coming in like walk of shaming it at 3 o'clock in the morning? Like, what's going on? I think that there's a heart in us that wants to protect each other from the dangers, the toxins of the world, the temptations and alluring footholds that are out there. But a more realistic approach than us just trying to live in this self-contained community, which has been tried for ages and ages and ages, by the way, people have done this forever. I think a more realistic approach is to really live in the world and not be of it, like what Scripture calls for. And that's what we're going to talk about today.
Yeah, it actually reminds me of one of the other questions that we got that's going to come up probably in the next couple of weeks, is the public versus private versus homeschooling debacle and controversy. Yeah. And it almost reminds me of the same thing, but as adults, you know, like, what can you be a part of? What can you be spend that much time doing and involved with?
Right.
People with different mindsets, different beliefs, and it still be a safe and
absolutely.
I don't know.
Absolutely. So for Ashley and I, you know, and people will go, different people will go to different scriptures here to sort of address this. But I think for Ashley and I, one of our founding principle scriptures is really in Paul's letter to the Corinthian church, which, by the way, the Corinthian church, they love the Lord, and they were learning to love each other. But they were having a tough time with where to draw the line on some sin issues, some worldly issues. Not all of them were just deep, dark, nasty sin. Some of it was just things that they were involved with. And so I want to read to you from the New American Standard Version.
Can you pick a different version?
1 Corinthians. Oh, here we go.
What about like New Living Translation?
For the love.
I feel like the NASB, I don't know who translated that, but it's almost like they wrote it every sentence like completely backwards so you couldn't understand it.
That's so weird that you say that. I feel like you're intimidated by how much truth there is in the American Standard Bible. It doesn't work into your web of lies.
That's definitely what it is.
Okay, so 1 Corinthians 10, verse 23, from the New Living Translation.
Thank you.
You say, I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is good for you. You say, I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is beneficial. Don't be concerned for your own good, but for the good of others. So this is really cool. And it goes on to break it down. It talks about meat sacrificed to idols and some stuff that's not super relevant to, you know, living in America in 2020. But these first few sentences are incredibly relevant, no matter when or where you ever could live. And a more appropriate translation says, everything is permissible, but not everything is profitable. Everything's lawful, but not everything is profitable.
Yeah, if you didn't get that, that was 1 Corinthians 10.
Verse 23, chapter 10. 24, something like that. So the point is, did you want to read it from the Passion?
I mean, I'm always willing to read from the Passion translation.
Please, by all means. Let's listen to it from the Passion translation.
What did you read? Just 23?
And 24, I think.
Okay, 23 and 24. You say, under grace there are no rules and we're free to do anything we please. Not exactly, because not everything promotes growth in others. Your slogan? We're allowed to do anything we choose. May be true, but not everything causes the spiritual advancement of others. So don't always seek what is best for you at the expense of another.
Okay, so that's actually a pretty good translation.
I got to
hand it to you.
I didn't want to say anything.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Brian Simmons. He came as a guest speaker to our church years ago, and he was so good. But this translation, it's unbelievable. So there you have it. I'm going to expand on that and incorporate in some other heart of God ideals from New Testament scripture and say that it's not just about what's best for others, but it's also about what's best for you.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's great that it does incorporate what's best for others. I think so many times we're so worried about our own walk that it's
You're
like,
right. But so many times, and I'll give you some examples of this in just a second, we do things and we say, well, if nobody else sees me do this, then it's okay.
That's true.
But really, it's not promoting growth in you.
Yep.
So let's talk about this. And we can start to throw out examples, but the problem that I have with examples is that they pigeonhole like a universal truth into this narrow application that doesn't fit a majority of people. So, but let's just throw something out like listening to secular music, because I think that's one example that,
that you struggle the most with. Is that what you wanted to say?
The funny thing is, I don't struggle with it at all.
Well, if you're worried about me, then you probably should struggle with it.
Because it causes you to stumble.
It definitely does.
So,
only when you put on that rap music.
Oh, for the love. I only listen to that because you caused me to stumble. Mm-hmm. So the thing is that if you say it's alcohol, or you say it's listening to secular music, or you say something like it's going to sporting events or some other secular gathering where people get excited about something, it's like, well, should I get excited? So Paul says this line, reminding everyone that, yes, there's this infinite amount of grace. And if we exercise our lives in the covering of that grace, then we can do so with the confidence that the Lord is with us in these things, but he's not always approving of those things. I was in India a while back, and part of a panel of folks who were talking to young people, youth and young adults. And one young musician was in the room that day, and he said, what are your convictions on playing secular music as a Christian in a bar type atmosphere or in a restaurant, that sort of thing? And basically in like a cover band or something like that. My conviction there as a musician who has played in both mostly Christian environments, but also some secular ones too, is that if you're going to hold that standard to musicians, or if you're going to hold that standard to anybody about anything, then you'd have to say, okay, that means no Christian can have a job or a hobby carried out in any kind of secular arena. Because you immediately paint this broad stroke and say, well, you're using your thing not for the glory of God, just because it's not done in a church. Or just because it's not done to Christian music, well, then that means that the guy who works at the factory that puts the little plastic thing around the end of the shoelaces every day, that means that that guy, because he doesn't go work in a church or do ministry, that means that he can't do his job unto the Lord, which is very antithetical to Scripture.
Right. I mean, later on, if you read farther down in chapter 10 there, it says everything you do, whether you're eating or drinking, everything you do, do it for the glory of God. So, I mean, really, you can do anything. I mean, obviously, if it's not causing you to like sin or somebody around you, obviously, to sin, then you can do anything. You can be involved in a hunting club or a golf league or all of these things. There's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong with it if you do it and bring glory to God through it.
Right. In fact, I think that by limiting those things, or by saying, oh, I probably shouldn't do this because it's not all Christians, or it's not specifically a church extracurricular activity or something like that, I think what we end up doing is we do cloister off the truth of the gospel to those who already have it. And, you know, evangelism is not my gifting necessarily, but I see, especially now more than ever, it's so important that Christians aren't just piling into a 15-passenger van and driving into downtown and telling everybody they're going to hell. Christians need to be Christians, like, out in those environments, and not just like the one Christian guy, you know, with your pleated khaki pants in the office building that holds the Bible study on Tuesday mornings.
I almost said there's nothing wrong with pleated khaki pants, but I probably shouldn't even say that.
Because there is. It causes people to stumble.
I know.
It just gets terrible.
But I remember that old school used to say, like, in the marketplace. That was like the old school Christianese way to say.
Well,
like,
that's because it's in the Book of Acts.
In the marketplace.
It's in the Book of Acts.
Oh, so it's from the Bible.
The marketplace.
That's what you're here for.
Yeah, it actually is. Yeah. So the truth is that we have to begin to participate in these other environments and arenas with our faith intact. And this is a harder thing to do. Let me tell you something. It's easier just to say, okay, I'm just never going to go to anywhere on this list, right, and I'm always going to go to anywhere on this list. That's the easier thing. The harder thing is to walk by the Spirit, to walk by the Spirit. And I've heard of stories of people walking past a bar and the Lord leading them inside, and they sit down with somebody and have a conversation that redirects somebody's entire life, and they accept the Lord, or they don't commit suicide, or they, you know, they don't leave their wife or whatever. And it's all because someone was led of the Lord to go to a place where they never would have been. Sounds a lot like Jesus. You know?
It does sound a lot like Jesus. But I feel like another piece of this that's so important is back to my balance thing, because I feel like the balance thing, I mean, you could be involved in everything and never go to a church on a Sunday because you're going to glorify God with whatever you're going to do. Mm. And you can quickly, like, that scale can so quickly tip.
Sure.
To, okay, now I'm involved in everything else. And I think that even being involved in everything else as a believer, there's a place to be poured into and a place to pour out. And if you're constantly in environments where you're only able to pour out, at some point you need to absorb something. And if you're never in a place where you're actually absorbing what's good for you, you'll start to absorb things around you that aren't good for you.
Oof, so good. That's so good. And that is exactly what Paul means when he says it is permissible, but it is not necessarily profitable.
Right.
It is permissible, it's lawful, but it's not necessarily beneficial. And so back to the secular music thing, okay?
You love
so
this one.
Nobody's in the car. You're by yourself, you're on your commute, and you love to, like, play that Led Zeppelin record or that Guns N' Roses record, or you love to put on your playlist, your drive to work or your drive home. You know you've got a different drive home playlist because you got to unwind. Or, like, if you're Ashley and you just got that Luda on repeat. But here's the deal. I think that we have to become incredibly wise and shrewd and discerning on where secular mediums take us. And it's not where we go taking them. It's where do they take us on an internal level. And I'll give you an example. A few years ago, I just moved up to New England, so it was like 15 years ago or something, 10, 15 years ago. And I remember driving to Attleboro and back and forth when I first got the job and lived in East Providence or Swansea or whatever. I was driving to Attleboro. And I remember being in the car and listening to some music, some not even bad secular music, it was just like secular, and feeling this heaviness come over my soul. And it brought back all of the sadness and the heaviness of losing my dad. And it was so crazy because in the same time, I got this gentle rebuke from the Lord that said, where's this taking you? And it was a reminder that, wait a minute, listening to music, you could listen to 99 secular songs and then not have that effect on you. But then there's another song and that song takes you down a road. And we were just talking to Christy the other day, mm-hmm. Christy Raposa, and she was saying the same thing. She's like, there's music that associates with my old lifestyle.
Right.
And I don't want to be that girl anymore. So I think that's what we need to be careful of. That's what we need to be mindful of. And that's what, is it lawful? Yes. Is it permissible? Yes. Does it take you somewhere you shouldn't go? Yes. Is it causing you to sin? Maybe not. But it certainly is not strengthening you. It certainly is not edifying you. And in fact, it could be doing the opposite.
Right. I mean, you always say, I mean, this from the Bible, but no, you say be wise to the schemes, but some people say schemes, but be wise to the schemes of the
enemy. Some people who don't have proper enunciation skills.
Schemes.
Say schemes. But I say schemes.
Schemes. Because I think you do need to know. I mean, I think you need to know where you're sensitive to, where your vulnerable places are, whether it's a history thing or just, I mean, as like a Christian who's like sensitive to the Holy Spirit, I think you need to know when things are just starting to take you down a wrong route.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. See the red flags. Know yourself. Know your heart. And no, wait a minute, I'm starting to feel this again.
Yeah, you feel like a little bit of a check,
don't
test it.
Right, go with it. Go with it and say, you know what? That's the Lord telling me I shouldn't do this. I shouldn't drink this or eat this or whatever. And I shouldn't say this. I shouldn't go here. It's going to, you know, be a slippery slope of where do I stop and how do I not? Because there was also something about that heaviness that feels a little bit good. There's something about that depression that is stirred back up, or that oppression that's stirred back up, that feels a little bit like home. In the same way that you had Israelites walking through the wilderness towards freedom, towards promises, and they catch a glimpse of something and it was like, you know what, I really miss Egypt. And there's something in our human nature, saints, that will draw us back to bondage. There's something that in that environment, in that atmosphere, you walk back into that bar. Now, you might be fine in 99 bars, but that one bar, the bar that you used to go to with your ex back when you were with this group of friends or back when you lived this lifestyle, now you go in that bar and this wave of stuff comes over you and there's a part of your flesh that says, this feels like home. People didn't judge me here. Have you ever said that? Or people, you know, respected me for who I was here.
Right. People always say it's great to walk down memory lane, but I don't think it always is.
Oh, yeah. Depends on what your memories are, I guess.
Right. Well, because memories can feel like home and they're not where home is.
They're your old home.
They're your old home.
You've got a new one.
Okay, so that covers our sensitivity and all those things. But what about the other side of that, which is like the other people, like in what we do, how it can either, you know, like mislead people. I think we can talk about two different things even with this side, which is like with Christians to another Christian and like different levels of freedom. And then where you have almost like the conviction side as a Christian, but you don't want it to cause somebody who's not a Christian to feel that they were like offensive because of their behavior and like turn away from the Lord because everybody's like a whole bunch of, you know.
Right. Well,
straight-laced.
I think a good example of that is our church's policy. And we don't have a ton of policies, but we have a policy on this. And that is that, first of all, we would never impose on anyone that you cannot have alcohol because we don't see the Lord doing that. However, we have a very strict rule that says if you are serving in any sort of leadership capacity in our church, that in the mixed company of other folks from our church, or especially in any church-sanctioned events or outings, you're totally prohibited from drinking. And the reason is because you have to be thinking bigger than yourself.
Right.
Or how much freedom you have.
It's not about
you
anymore.
It really does. Well, it is edifying for me because it helps me relax or whatever. I think
being helped to relax, like, is that edifying?
Well, for you, I think sometimes it might be. Where Ashley and I don't drink, but I think that churches have gone way too far in trying to mandate some sort of order here where the word doesn't really do that.
Right.
And so we need to be careful about that. But you're back to edifying. Okay, am I looking to something to edify me? And there's another whole level there. It's not, I know we're kind of going back and forth with whether it's about other people or whether it's about you. But in this case, it's about both. Do I need to reach for something to edify me? Do I need to reach for something to benefit me or strengthen me that's beyond the realm of my faith and my walk with God? That's beyond the scheme or scope, I think is the right word. That's beyond the scope of my faith and my, you know, being led by the Spirit. So back to the other person, it's not worth it. It's not worth losing your ability to lead, to guide, to influence. It's not worth causing somebody to stumble.
Right. And I think for us, I mean, I can't tell you how many times people have said, do you guys drink? Do you guys drink? Do you guys drink? And sometimes, I mean, if I'm going to be honest, sometimes saying no, you feel like, oh, it must just be because they're like so uptight. Like there's a little bit in me that wants to like, it's not because we're so perfect, like trying to be so perfect or something. It's, I would never want to be the reason that somebody opened themselves up to that vice in life,
right,
and it took it was a slippery slope for them.
Right.
Like, can you imagine, like, as a leader, you know? And I think that if we approach everything like that,
right,
in a, you know, what's better for somebody else, then I get to enjoy an earthly pleasure.
Well, yeah. Oh, that's so good. And so, you know, some context again for me. So you've heard on here, if you've listened to all these, my dad was a really bad alcoholic and his addiction was the reason for my parents' divorce. And so we kind of grew up under this villainous sort of perspective on alcohol, that it was like, you know, the worst thing since the devil. And associated brokenness in our home, losing our dad, our abuse with my mom, everything orbited around the idea of alcohol. Now, I was not just immediately free from that. You know, it was over years, and I remember being in middle school and the early years of high school, and I would see people I knew who were Christians, would watch them drink, and it like sent my head spinning, like totally reeling, because I'm like, wait a minute, how can they do that when alcohol does X, Y, and Z and all this other stuff? And I think now back, because I had been taught a certain thing or had experienced a certain thing and watched alcohol destroy my family. So it, even though I wasn't at risk of like, oh, if I see somebody drink, then I could, it could open the door to me. Now I'm going to become an alcoholic, or I'm going to go back to drinking after being free from it for so long. But no, for me, it was just their ability to minister in my life was limited by that, because that's where I was spiritually.
Right. And you come into contact with people all the time that are at all those different places. And if we look back at 1 Corinthians 10 again, in verse 33, it says, follow my example, for I try to please everyone in all things rather than putting my liberties first. I sincerely attempt to do anything I can so that others may be saved. And if that is always our hearts, then we're going to be in a good position for those around us to get saved. And that's always our priority, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think when we can walk that balance and we can be led of the Lord and we can, you know, operate and live in freedom, but again, kind of like that First Peter passage that I just preached on Sunday, you know, we can act as free men, but not use our freedom as a covering to do evil, not use our freedom as a stumbling block for somebody else. I think we're winning. I think the kingdom's winning.
Yeah, and as we get ready to close in the next few minutes, one last thing that I had on my heart was kind of just to be able to assess the situation of where you are and who's around you. You know, we talk about people who are so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good, you know, and I know that's kind of like an extreme.
Why'd you look at me when you said that?
Because you're so heavenly minded. Mm-hmm. No. You know, whether it's a mom at a soccer game or you're hanging out with people from work, you know, and you're having a lunch break and your whole conversation is about what went on at church this weekend, and it makes church sound like a whole bunch of crazy people because they can't relate. Or
church is a bunch of crazy people, for the record.
It definitely can be. But if our goal and our heart is to get people saved, is for other people to see the love of Christ, I don't think it's always pointing out how different we are than them. Sometimes I think that can draw like lines in the sand of why we're so different, and then make people feel like they'll never either be good enough. Mm-hmm. Or, and I think Christians are super guilty of that, you right. know, like always coming across as perfect or so righteous that it either draws a line and says other people are never going to be good enough, or that other extreme, which is like they're all a bunch of like crazy people, right. and I'm not interested because of that. And so being able to assess your situation, assess your surroundings, who you're with, and how can I make Jesus in this situation be appealing
right.
to you, you know?
Yeah, I think the apostles were really good at that too. I mean, the New Testament church, you see Paul walking around on missionary journeys and saying, yeah, this God that you're worshiping that you don't even know the name of, I know that God. And he starts reading back to them their own poetry, because he understood that in order for people to have a framework or reference or context for God, the Lord would use what they already knew. And I think that when we are willing to do that and break out of our own molds for the sake of others, so that they can be edified, so that they can be strengthened, so that they can be baptized into the body of believers, I think we'll find our efforts to be so much more fruitful.
Right. And you were saying you're not an evangelist, and I am not an evangelist either. But I think we have to be able to, like, no matter whether we're an evangelist or not, be able to reach people where they are.
Yeah, and I think that's so important, and just as a responsible believer. And I think to close, we need to call on the mature believer. We need to appeal to the heart of the mature believers who are listening to this, and who are praying to see the kingdom come. And that call is, how is your exercise of your freedom helping that to happen? Because one example that, you know, we talk about a lot is, you know, are you free to not come to church? Yeah, you are free. We don't have to live under the legalism of not coming to of having to be in church every Sunday.
Right, you're like, Christianity doesn't rely on whether or not you attend church on Sundays.
Correct. However, just because it's possible doesn't mean it's profitable to not come.
Right.
Just because it's lawful now, because we're not under that law anymore, it doesn't mean that it's beneficial to you. And I think that's a perfect example of how exercising that freedom, we can make someone who's not as strong of a Christian, who's actually more dependent. It's kind of like how babies can't go as long between meals.
Right.
You know, like when little mammals are born and they nurse like every couple hours when they first start. I think that there's a truth to that for younger believers too. And as you get older, you can go longer and longer between eating. And then you have these like tortoises that are 200 years old and they'll go for like 2 weeks without a meal.
Thanks, Coyote Peterson.
Well, you know, everybody needs something here. But
I mean, if you look at, like, I mean, we've talked about even tithing with this before, because there's so many things that were in the Old Testament. And then we find ourselves in a New Testament era. And it's just because we're not under the law anymore doesn't mean we just stop doing that. Because there's freedom.
Right.
You know, like there's so many principles there that we still need to.
And it doesn't have anything to do with you getting into heaven.
Exactly.
But you just have to be responsible about it. And that's all the way from everything we've talked about today, all the way out to anything that you're involved in. Well, I really love to watch scary movies. I personally love to watch scary movies.
And I think they're of the devil.
And I have to, if I'm going to see something that's edgy or thriller or whatever, I have to do that responsibly, knowing, what am I opening myself up to? What am I opening up my home to? Do I want my kids exposed to this, you know? And the answer is clearly, emphatically, no, I don't. Well, then why am I doing it? Well, I have the freedom to do it.
That's a good question, Zach.
Right? I have the freedom to do it. Well, am I being strengthened by it? Am I being edified by it? And so it brings us back to, okay, we have to ask ourselves those hard questions and be willing to accept the real answer of it and not just stop when we think we've done enough. It's like, okay, Lord, search my heart, know my heart. Why am I not going to church? Why am I propagating that my own freedom for that? What do I have to prove?
Right. And I think after you ask the question to yourself and like, do I need to be in church on Sundays? Maybe you're like a super mature believer and know you don't need to be in church on Sundays. And then ask yourself, does somebody else need me to be in church on Sundays?
Whoa.
And sometimes the answer is most definitely yes, especially if you are a mature believer.
Right.
It's not, you know, we've said this before, it's not about you.
It's not about you.
Other people like need you to pour out what you've been poured into over decades and decades of your walk with Christ.
Right. Be a part of somebody else's victory now. Yep. All right. Well, we're going to close in prayer. And I just, again, thank you for listening and praying that, you know, we can all like hear this with an open heart and be able to really receive whatever it is the Lord wants to receive in you. Hopefully that you're able to hear beyond the examples that were given. And hopefully you're able to really make some applications to whatever's going on in your life, knowing that, hey, I have been given freedom and I have been given grace. And what I'm doing isn't a sin, but let me make sure that I'm still prioritizing the things that God has given me to strengthen me and make sure that I am prioritizing above my own satisfaction or fulfillment. I am putting the growth of others and the strengthening and the birthing of others ahead of me.
Right. And I would encourage you to jump into the scriptures this week. Read that 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 23 through 33, like several times, and ask the Lord really to show you what in your life this might be applying to.
And read it in the right translation.
The New Living Translation or the Passion Translation.
Or apparently anything but the New American Standard, which is the Bible I preach from every Sunday.
If you want to really minister to you.
Oh, for the love. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much, Lord. We thank you so much for that grace and for that freedom. And we thank you that even when we abuse it and manipulate it and twist it, Lord, with our own selfish desires, we thank you that you don't take it away. But instead, Lord, you help us to walk in a better understanding of it. So that's our prayer today, that you would help us all walk in a better understanding of what it means to be free, what it means to live as free men, but with the hope and the prayer that others would be drawn towards you and not away from you. Others would be drawn towards the body of Christ and not away from it because of how we walk in it and exercise it. So we love you, Lord. We pray for discernment over our body. We pray over our church body. We pray for wisdom, Lord, that we would be able to know what we should or could or can or shouldn't engage in, participate in, Lord, and that, we would grow in our faith and others would as well because of it. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
All right, guys, that wraps up another week. So go subscribe, go like it, go share it with your friends, and we'll see you next Friday.
Later.
This is Nestor.
And I'm Willa.
This is Our House from A to Z.
Thanks for coming over.